Okay, so good evening, everyone, and welcome to this, the first installment of season 11 of the Honors Program's CBC Speaker Series. If you would now all take your telephones and turn them off, and please resist the urge to answer that vibrating text or call throughout the course of the evening. Let's be a good audience for our guests tonight. Okay, that being done, please join me in beginning our evening tonight as we begin all things at CBC here and then is with prayer. So let us remember that we are in the holy presence of God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is called the prayer of the athlete. Lord, let me play well but fairly. Let competition make me strong but never hostile. In this and in all things, guide me to the virtuous path. If I know victory, grant me happiness. If I am denied, keep me from envy. See me not when I am sheared, but when I bend to help up my opponent. See within my heart that everyone who takes the field with me becomes my brother. Remind me that sports are just games. Teach me something that will matter once the games are over. And if through athletics I set an example, let it be a good one. These things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. St. John Baptist of the South, lift Jesus in our hearts. Love that. Thank you. Okay, once again, I want to welcome you and thank you again for coming out tonight. Those of you who are new to the program, freshman parents, what I try to do here is based loosely on the St. Louis Speaker Series. I bring in men and women from all walks of life, be it science, technology, law, medicine, politics, law enforcement, military, athletics, the arts, and so on. People who have been given a gift of some sort, who have developed that gift to the best of their ability, and have somehow found a way to give back. All of you young men in the audience tonight have been given a gift. It is my hope that you will recognize that gift at some point in your life. You will develop it to the best of your ability, and when it is all said and done, you will be able to give back. I really like that passage from one of Luke's Gospels that reads, "To whom much is given, much is expected." Typically, this is the part of the introduction where I tell you things and you listen, but I thought tonight it would be better if you see things, if I show you things and you see them. Many of you were not born while Isaac Bruce was plying his trade out of the dome. So we're going to show you a little video here. It lasts about 4.5 minutes. Hold on, Austin.
Thank you.
more receiving yards than Isaac Bruce. That's why the man is headed for Canton, Ohio, Hall of Fame. Okay, that's an example of someone who had a gift, who developed it to the best of his ability, and then was able to, he didn't stop there. In 2006, he launched the Isaac Bruce Foundation, which focuses on health, wellness, nutrition, fitness, and education. Here are a few of the services that organization provides. Of course, the scholarship program. The Flight 300 program, which provides transportation to college-bound students in need. A free football clinic, which is put on every summer for 500 youngsters who learn skills not only in football, but in teamwork, sportsmanship, and esteem building often on the field. And a literacy efforts program, partnering with Ready Readers to donate books to underserved preschool students in the St. Louis area. So, there's the gift, there's the development, and there's the giving back. That's the whole package. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome please for our special guest tonight, Mr. Isaac Bruce.
Enjoyed every moment of it. we enjoy giving you guys memories. I think I first got here in St. Louis in 1995 when the Los Angeles Rams turned into the St. Louis Rams, and I never realized how hot a place could be. I grew up in Florida, but there's always a breeze because we're right there on the Atlantic with the constant breeze. From there, I went to junior college in Santa Monica City College in Los Angeles, California, and that was totally different. But when I got here, it's like the heat just hugged you, and we had to practice in that thing two times a day. So I kind of got used to it. I much prefer the heat over the cold weather. You know, probably some of you guys in here can attest to that. But tonight, I kind of want to talk to you about a couple things. I know we have some athletes in here, some student athletes. I was asked to speak about perseverance, and I'd like to also just commend you guys and say, publicly here that I thank you and I honor you the way you magnify Jesus. It's big to me. It's huge. Thank you for doing that. It's humbling to me. I want to go right into perseverance. And I kind of mentioned my 2 years in junior college. I grew up in South Florida. I went to Dillard High School. One of 15 children. I have 14 brothers and sisters, 8 sisters, and 6 brothers. And you got a sister, trust me. I had about 9 mothers. So I had dreams coming out of high school, probably like many of you. I wanted to go straight from high school to a Division I program. Division I program, I wanted to be drafted in the pros. I knew at a very young age, probably around 12 years old, that I would be a professional football player. We all have dreams, we all have paths that we think we should take, and we all think that it should go from A to B. I'm here to tell you that it doesn't always work out that way. I was a athlete student while I was in high school. So I was big on the athletic guy, but as far as the academics, you can miss me with that. And there were other things that I'd rather be doing. So I had to pay the price for that. I ended up with a scholarship offer to the University of Purdue. When it came time to go to Purdue, when it came time to take the SAT, the ACT, I didn't score high enough. So therefore, my scholarship was pulled from me. Now, we're talking about perseverance. I looked up this word, perseverance, and the definition I got is a continuance in a state of grace to a state of glory. So if you're taking notes, perseverance, a continuance in a state of grace to a state of glory. I had this big dream of one day just being drafted, being the first pick in the NFL, walking across the stage, looking at Mr. Paul Tagliabue at the time, who was the commissioner. And that was my focus as a youngster. When my scholarship was pulled, I was automatically disappointed. Initially, I thought my dream was over. I had the opportunity to quit and go do something different. It wasn't too long, I received a phone call for an offer to go to a junior college in Southern California, Santa Monica City, where I ended up playing 2 years. First got there, I played on an offense that was an option team. If you guys know, they run the ball, they got that triple option thing going, fake it to the fullback, quarterback will run away, pitch it to the halfback. That really wasn't conducive for a wide receiver like myself who liked catching a lot of footballs. So I had to block a lot. So I was constantly blocking and not catching enough balls. So that kind of upset me. So I would always ask myself, how can I get to a Division I college by just blocking? I didn't know many, Division I programs that were, into their wide receivers blocking and not catching passes for them. You understand? So after my first season, there was a change in the coaching staff, and from there, we kind of opened it up a little bit. So we went to a 3 wide receiver set. Still got my dreams going, but it's not going, I planned it out. So My second year, my sophomore year in college, I was a third wide receiver. So you normally start with two, but I was the guy coming off the bench. So that means I didn't start. It's kind of like Michael Jordan's story. He got cut from his basketball team in high school. Me, here I am a junior, looking to play in the Division I program, but I'm at a junior college, and I'm not starting. So for about 3 or 4 weeks, you know, I'd be calling my mom and, you know, complaining and telling her the coach didn't like me, and I don't think I'm gonna do it, and I don't know what's wrong with it. Can he see my talent? Can he see my dream? Doesn't he know who I am? Apparently not. So, you know, thank God for mothers and thank God for fathers. They kept me on the straight path and kept me focusing on my dream as opposed to focusing on the journey that I was taking at the time. Because the journey may change, but your dream, your end goal, should never change. Always keep that dream before your eyes. So, fortunately and unfortunately, one of the receivers got hurt. I think he twisted an ankle, pulled a hamstring, something, but you know, I was put into the starting lineup. And from there, I made plays, met coaches. A guy by the name of Urban Meyer, he recruited me to go to Colorado State at that time. And met another guy by the name of Randy Fietner. And he was at the University of Memphis at that time. It's kind of funny because at that time I was used to making choices based off what was in front of me. And I figured out that being a kid from South Florida, currently living in Los Angeles, California, Fort Collins, Colorado just wasn't the place for me. They brought me up on a visit, and on this visit, they brought me on the football field. It was January. And I promise you, there was a bowl, ice bowl, the size of this podium right here on the field. And apparently they didn't read my bio, because they saw the look on my face. Coach Meyer would have known there was no way I'm coming to school here. So I ended up choosing Memphis. From the moment I got to Memphis State, I was introduced to something that really helped me change my life. It was called a weight room. Something you guys probably live in right now. But as a junior, if you can believe it or not, I mean, I know you look at me and say, man, he's a big, swole, you know, yoked up guy. But as a junior, you know, I was one of those guys who could not bench 135. You know, I get under that weight, and that weight would try to lift me, and it just wasn't happening. But being encouraged by my coaches, being encouraged by my teammates, and constantly going back, it changed. It changed my confidence level. It changed my speed. I went from about a 4.7 as a junior in college to running about 4.5. I always thought I was fast, but I found out I wasn't one day when I got to practice out in Memphis and I saw a lot of fast guys running, and I wasn't leading any of the races. So that was a smack in my face. But just continuing to have a dream of making it and being selected in the draft. It stayed with me all the way through my junior year. Now my senior year, I developed another dream. I think my first dream was just to be on an NFL team. I was a big time Miami Dolphin fan coming from South Florida. Dan Marino was my guy. Now, my dream changed a little bit. Now, when it's time to adjust your dream, I always think that you should go upward and not reduce your dream. So my dream went from just being in the NFL to being the number one wide receiver taken in the country. And I remember vividly, like it was last night, I get a phone call in my dorm room probably a week and a half before the draft is coming around. And my phone rings, and when I pick up and I say hello, it's the Miami Dolphins. Miami Dolphins called me and they asked me two questions. First question, I thought was kind of weird. He said, would you be interested in playing for the Miami Dolphins? I said, yeah. I like the Miami Dolphins. I grew up a Miami Dolphin fan. I never met Dan Marino, but I like him. Mark Duke, they were the wide receivers that were there at that time. But you know, my whole history with football was then a Miami Dolphin fan. Second question was, what was your fastest 40 time that you've ever run? So at that time, I had a decision to make. I mean, this guy never met me when I was at the combine. He never interviewed me. So, you know, maybe I could just, you know, tell him I ran like a 4.3 or 4.2. Yeah, you know, I started to, but I ended up telling him I ran a 4.41, which was my best time at my pro day at the University of Memphis. So he calls and he says, all right, thank you. We'll consider drafting you. And that was the last I ever heard of the Miami Dolphins. It didn't happen. That happened several times leading up to the draft in 1994. I got another call from the Seattle Seahawks. And I got a call from the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Pittsburgh Steelers in 1994 had the 17th pick, and they were in need of a wide receiver. Now, it came down between myself and a guy by the name of Charles Johnson out of Colorado Buffaloes. Now, I had seen Charles play numerous times. I mean, every time I turned around, they were on ABC playing against Mizzou, you know, playing against Texas. And Charles Johnson, he'd run certain routes, right, maybe a slant, but, you know, I wasn't really impressed. So they told me it would come down between myself and Charles Johnson, and I really didn't know what the decision process was, because number one, I knew me and I knew I was the best, and I was constantly asking myself, how can I convince these guys that I'm your man, I'm the one that you need to take? So I did everything from telling my agent to, you know, why don't you fly to Pittsburgh, or why don't we fly to Pittsburgh, you know, we put on some disguises and we go find Chuck Noble and tell Chuck Noble I'm his guy. And then when he says, you know, where is he? Where can I talk to him? I just pop out and say, here I am. That's how my mind was turning at that time. Well, fortunately and unfortunately, that didn't happen. I ended up being the seventh wide receiver taken in the 1994 draft. And I was picked by a team, the Los Angeles Rams at the time, who never interviewed me, never came to visit me, never flew me out for a visit. Never spoke to any of their coaches. I remember the one time they came to Memphis to watch the practice. The scout left and he said, you know what, I can't use anybody on this field. So within probably 3 months, that whole thing changed, because I ended up being the second pick, their second pick that season, the 33rd pick overall. And to me, just everything that was happening was behind the scenes, really culminated into me being drafted by the Rams, and then my career started to take off from there. During those times in high school, during those times in junior college, there was times where I had to just really encourage myself. There were times that and I don't know if you guys know about junior college. In junior college, where I came from, you were responsible for paying your own tuition. There were no scholarships. You were responsible for paying for your books. You're responsible for your travel, for the upkeep of your own jerseys, your own pants, everything. You were responsible for it. So, being from the inner city, I didn't have any resources at that time, but I learned one important thing, which was to encourage myself. I came up with a mantra, and I believe it was my second year of junior college. My mantra was, I will not quit, and I will not be defeated, and I shall be victorious. This is something I would tell myself continuously. I'd wake up in the morning and I'd remind myself that I would not quit, I would not go home, I would not be defeated, and I shall be victorious. Well, those words started turning to me every day. I'd say them. I'd make it one of my mantras. Before I go on the field and play, those are things that I would remind myself and tell myself that I wasn't a quitter, I won't be defeated, and I shall be victorious. So those words started getting older, and I started getting stronger and saying them. And those words started coming to pass in my life. I mean, day after day, I'd see the change. I'd see the confidence level start to skyrocket. And I truly believe that those words really paved the path for me to be drafted in the second round, to have the success that I had on the football field, to being a possible Pro Football Hall of Famer. Those words, I even speak them today, they are set ablaze and making a path for me. So, we talk about perseverance, we talk about honor. Honor is real important to me. There are things that we should honor. The Bible talks about honor. There are people that we should honor. Number one on our list, as far as honor is concerned, we should honor God. We should honor the Most High. And how do we do that? We honor God by following His Word, saying yes to His Word, spending time with Him, fellowshipping with Him. God in His Word instructs us to honor our fathers and our mothers. It instructs us to follow their instructions, to let them be leaders to us, others that we should honor, our elders. We should honor ourselves, our bodies. We should honor positions, the presidents. We should honor our principals. We should honor our intuition. We should honor those who are, I'd say, coaches over us. Quick story, in 2006, we got a brand new coaching staff with the Rams, and one of the assistant coaches, who was placed over myself and the quarterbacks at that time, was a guy that was in the same draft as me in 1994. So, I think he was a second round pick, didn't work out for him, so he ended up going into coaching. So when I found out that this guy was hired to be my coach now, as you can imagine, I had a couple reservations about it because I'm thinking, well, this guy was in my draft class. He got drafted in 1994, just like me, second round pick, and had a cup of coffee in him. He didn't last too long, but now he's my coach. So I figured I knew more than this guy. But at the same time, you know, just talking about honor, I knew I had to honor this position because, you know, number one, he was my coach. And I made a pact with myself that anybody that was my coach, I can learn something from him. And we had a chat, and I told him that I'd do anything that he asked me to do. I'd play hard for him, try to make his job as easy as possible and make him as successful as possible as I could. So I went out every day, I put my feelings to the side, and I said, yes sir, no sir, how do you want me to do this? And ran everything by him. And funny thing is, I ended up having one of the better seasons that I ever had by making that decision. So if that can help you, honor the position, honor the coaching position that you have, honor your teachers and your administrators, honor them by following their advice and their words. It's important. Now, we're going to have an opportunity for questions and answers. I won't answer anything, but just want to move you guys to whatever you want, and I reserve the right to answer or not answer. All right?
Okay, you guys. Be sure you speak loudly so we can all hear your question. All right, go. Loudly.
Is concerned. I'm a little torn because I was drafted in Los Angeles Rams in 1994 and we moved here in 1995. And I can honestly say, I didn't want to leave Los Angeles. You ever been to Los Angeles? Los Angeles is nice. The weather is nice. I mean, 70 degrees, you know, grass everywhere. You know, we were playing on grass and, you know, there's some beautiful people out there, you know, Hollywood. Came to St. Louis, I was like, man, I was a little disappointed. But I quickly fell in love with St. Louis, quickly fell in love with the people. They embraced me. And when the team decided to leave St. Louis, I was truly disappointed. But not just for the team, but for the fans. I think the fans gave us everything they had. They were supportive of us. There were some lean years here in St. Louis, but the fans were always showed up. From that standpoint, I was disappointed. Yes, sir.
Where do you feel about Professionals.
Oh, okay. All right. I think I've had four documented concussions, two where I blacked out. And I guess, from recent studies, it says that anytime you see stars, it's a concussion. So I've lost count on the number of times I've saw stars. I've seen a lot of stars, and I'm not talking about, Halle Berry, but it's football is a rough, tough sport, but there are ways to be more safe in this game. I think there's a lot of light being shined on proper tackling techniques, proper collision techniques. It's a collision sport. If I had to do it all over again, I would. I mean, football is a game that I love, and it's afforded me a lot of luxuries in life, and just the competition of it. I think it's the best sport in America. It's competitive. I think from a fan standpoint, I think when you're working and the stresses of the job can take over you, I think sometimes you want to hit something. I think football can supplement that for a lot of people. I think a lot of light is being shined on it as it should be, and honestly, I'd be cautious, but football has to be for you. I mean, if it's not for you, there are a ton of things to do, but it has to be for you. And I've heard a lot of other people say that you have to be a little off your rocker to play football professionally, and that's true. That's true. However long you play, just be off your rocker for 5-6 years and get back on your rocker when you're done. But, to have 225-pound guys running 4-3s, 4-4s, colliding each other, it's good, but it's not good. I mean, in the long term, it may catch up with you, but, like I said, if I had to do it again, I'd do it again in a heartbeat. Yes, sir. Okay, now I respected them all because I felt like if you were in the NFL, you earned the right to be there. And you've been scrutinized from a standpoint of a lot of other guys didn't make it, but you're here. So I respected them all. Now as far as the best, I'd say there really wasn't a guy. I'd say there was a type. And the type would be a guy who studied. So a guy who came and he could tell if where I was lining up, which route I was gonna run, or the formation of the offense, or which play was gonna be run, or if he could just get in the way. If he could stop the play, he could get in the way. Those type guys always gave me, they gave me a little trouble. And guys like Aeneas Williams, he was always watching film. He was a ball hawk. He wasn't very fast, so just his knowledge of the game really propelled him to be, he's in the Hall of Fame. So, those type defensive backs. But anyone else, man, I'm doing them in. Well, I met Coach Vermeil, when he was hired here. I had heard about him. I think he had been on a 14-year hiatus before he got hired here in St. Louis. And I knew he was an old school guy. And what I mean by that is that, his thing was to break you all the way down and build you back up. So I kind of anticipated him coming and being the coach. I think I got in probably the best shape I ever could that all season, and he's a small guy, but he's tough as nails, and he demands a lot from his players. And from an honoring standpoint, I always followed his leadership. I think that he left the Rams way too early. I think that had he been here, we'd probably be the New England Patriots. I truly believe that. I think that he brought a quality and a character about himself where he could make his coaches do what needed to be done. and I think he left too early. I think he's one of the most loyal guys that I've ever met. We had our clashes, but it never got personal. He was at my wedding. He'll call me probably once every month or so just to ask me how I am, and we have great conversations. But one of the most loyal guys I've ever met, Coach B. Yes, sir. Backstory? My ankle braces. Ankle braces. So I didn't like getting taped. So you guys probably get taped and tape your ankles up. I always thought that wore out my ankles and got sweaty and the tape got a little soft. I really couldn't play with them. So I always wore like ankle braces, straps. So we're getting ready to play the first playoff game here in St. Louis ever, right? Versus the Minnesota Vikings. It was a highly hyped game. And, you know, the Saturday before the game, it's your job to pack all of your pads, your shoulder pads, your helmets, your ankle braces, and put them in this big bag and make sure they're there. So, you know, I'm just chilling in the locker room Sunday, and I start to get dressed. Well, first thing I do, I go from feet all the way up the head, and I put my first pair of socks on, and I started looking for my ankle braces, and they're nowhere to be found. So I go and ask Jimmy Lake, who's our trainer. Yo, dude, where's my ankle braces, man? They're in your locker. I was like, no, they're not. I'm like, I'm just at my locker and I'm looking for them. So I start to panic a little bit. So when I panic, it makes him panic even more. So he runs and goes and gets one of the city policemen and tells him that he left my ankle braces. I always blame it on him. He left my ankle braces in my locker. So someone's got to go get them. It's probably... always got dressed probably 2 hours before the game. Now I'm down about 45 minutes. So 45 minutes before the game, he solicits a police officer. They get in his car, they ride, shoot down 40, and jumps on 70, doing 95 miles per hour with the lights on. Both ways, coming back, and got my ankle braces probably 25 minutes before the game. Now that was fast. I think someone should have made a citizen's arrest. He got those ankle braces, and I was able to put them on and we played. So I didn't know it was a big story to after the game, honestly. Yes, right.
Can you tell us a little bit about your faith journey and how your faith developed over your life?
Absolutely. So we know faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So my mother was a you gotta be a believer to have 15 children. So she had 15 children. My mom was a believer. My mom spent time as being a pastor, and she made sure that, you know, we were developing God's word. It started off forcefully. There was some rebellion, but the Bible says train a child in the way that he should go. When he's old, he won't depart from it. So after the rebellion part of it, we all came back. I mean, I had my moments where, you know, I didn't want to hear that. And I ended up coming back. There were moments in my life where I think around 26 years of age where I started really to read the Bible for myself and just develop that relationship with the Lord. And he proved himself true to me and made me honestly say, I wish I had done this earlier. And mom was right. Yes, sir.
Can you talk about what motivated you being in high school athletes or training students? And a little bit about the goal setting.
I say motivation for me personally, just you know what, I'm one of those athletes that you know, I wanted to have a better life or make a better life for my parents. I grew up in the inner city. And I always believed that we could have more, and we could do better. That was part of my motivation. I think all through high school, I didn't know a professional athlete was paid to play. I mean, I thought Dan Marino was just doing that because that's what he loved to do. So I kind of took that mentality, that attitude. And just the goal setting part was, Number one, I think we have an inner scream, an inner image on the inside of all of us that we can place something on that image. Mine was making it to the pros, being a professional athlete, and we can just hang on it. I think there are even ways to fortify that by, you know, writing out that goal. I think writing a goal is really when it really becomes a goal. Until you write it out, until you put pen to paper, it's just a wish. You know, I've come to learn that, you know, that's a principle that, you know, where once we put things to paper, it becomes a goal. And once I learned that, I think things became a lot more easier for me. Another goal that I had was to become the best route runner in the NFL. I saw the benefits of being a good route runner. I made that one of my goals. I wrote it down. That was something that I would call myself constantly. And, you know, it wasn't long before other commentators who were commentating my game started saying, you know, this guy is the best route runner in the league. So it didn't start with him, it started with me. By just jotting it and just putting it on paper and manifesting.
During the 1999-2000 season, during the Super Bowl, what were your thoughts as the Tennessee Titans players running down the field towards the end zone?
That last drive? Okay. Okay, so my thoughts was, I knew we were dealing with one of the toughest competitors to ever play football, and Steve McNair. And there were two significant plays that made me lose my breath. One was, I don't know if you guys remember, Dre Bly intercepted the ball. No, he almost intercepted the ball. Did he intercept it? If he intercepted it, they called it back because of a penalty. But he intercepts the ball, and I think he intercepts the ball. He always wanted to be Deion Sanders. So he intercepts the ball, he starts to showboat with the ball. So I saw myself run off the field and run onto the field to grab him and just start choking him because I don't think he understood the magnitude of the moment. He was a rookie at the time. But the second was when Steve McNair had a total of 600 pounds wrapped around his neck and he pushes him off with one hand, stands up and delivers a strike to his receiver. That made me really lose my breath because I knew for a fact that was going to be the very first Super Bowl to go into overtime, the way they were moving the football down the field. And my thought process was either get a fumble, interception, or just make them, you know, turn the ball over on downs. And that whole time, man, I'm just, you know, away from the crowd. The crowd would be on this end, and I prefer to watch the game down here by myself. I'd watch the snap of the ball on the jumbotron and then turn and look at the play here and see what happened. So when Mike Jones makes this tackle, Mike Jones was the linebacker who tackled Andre Dyson on the 1 yard line to seal the deal. When he made that, man, that was every dream that I ever had, that I had lived about 1,000 times in my own backyard. So that was my emotions, those were my feelings. Say again?
You haven't played football.
You know what? I get asked that question at times, but I think football was a part of my brand, part of my makeup, so I had to do the football thing. I think while being a football player, I had the opportunity to teach a lot of guys the game itself. I had the privilege of tutoring guys. I can name a bunch of them, some who matured in it and some who didn't, but I think football was a part that gave me, you know, the platform to teach these guys how to be professionals, how to run routes, how to win, and how to experience and how to react to losses. And I think football was a part of that. So I think football, I had to do football and not really just stay in football, but just spend that season there and then move on to my next thing. So,
real quick, can you talk a little bit about the importance of mentors and people, and maybe talk
I actually put that on my notes, but a mentor, I think mentors are one of the most important assets that an athlete, that a person, that a homemaker, that anyone, a banker, a broker, anyone can have. I think when I got drafted in 1994, I was 21 years old. And I knew that I had to link up with someone or someones to teach me to be a professional, to teach me how to navigate this professional game. I met a guy, it's funny because we were playing the same position. He was a Z and I was a Z. We had an X, Y, and Z, and I played Z, he played Z, by the name of Jesse Hester. And he was one of the best route runners I ever seen. So now, with him being my mentor, and within the ranks of professional football, there's certain things that you have to do. There are things that are written and unwritten. So it was okay for me to have to carry his pads in after practice every day. I didn't mind doing it because he was providing a service for me. It was okay for me to take his helmet in. It was okay for me to make chicken runs with the chance of missing the team flight to get this guy some chicken. Because he had to have his chicken. It's just the way it was. Not only him, but another guy by the name of Flip Anderson. So now I got two mentors. So that means I got to get extra chicken. That means I got to take two sets of shoulder pads in, helmet. I got to keep this guy's locker straightened out, you know, the way he likes it. But he was providing me a service. Every time that I got on the field and he didn't like what he saw, he would correct me. And I gave him that opportunity to speak into my life, to speak into my game. And he gave me little nuggets that I could use in my game. And I remember one time in particular, we were playing the Carolina Panthers in 1995. I had become a starter then. So I took his job. And we were playing in Death Valley. It was the Carolina Panthers' inaugural season. And I got my first 100-yard game. And the first guy over to congratulate me and tell me that I had reached that pinnacle of 100 yards in the game was Jesse Hester. And he said, "You know what? You don't have to carry my pads anymore." And I said, "Thank you, sir." I said, "What about the chicken?" He said, "You don't have to get the chicken." But mentors are so important. Yes, sir. Yes. That vehicle that we use, goal setting is big. I mean, back of 2 and 4, it says write the vision, make it plain. And that's one of the principles that I use. I think one of my goals is for my daughters. We sat down, school just started Monday back in Florida. So we sat down and rewrote her vision out for the entire school year. So we jotted down 6 things that we expected to happen. And that last one was that she be student of the year at Central Park Elementary School. And she's in the second grade, mind you. And so she tells me, she says, "They don't even have that at this school." I say, "Well, guess what? You're gonna be the first one." So that's the goal that we set. And I'm just, you know, I'm teaching her the importance of it. So I'm training her up in the way that she should go and to use these principles herself. So, and one thing, another thing about goal setting and about putting your dreams on paper, I don't think you can ever dream too big. You know, I don't think you can dream too big. Because I mean, I went from just wanting to be drafted to being the first receiver taken in the draft. So my dreams went up, and they should always go up. And like I said, your dreams always should be bigger than your memories. Yes, sir.
What was your reaction to Spygate?
Spygate? Did you YouTube this? You're way too young, man. My reaction? You know, I heard Ladainian Tomlinson say, he said this one time. He just went into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. He said, "If you ain't cheating, you ain't trying." So I was upset. When the news of it came out, I was upset. And you know what? It's funny because things started to make sense. You know, we had played the Patriots earlier that season in Foxborough on grass, cold night, and we beat them up pretty good. So I'm thinking when we see them in the Super Bowl, controlled climate, on turf, turf is our surface, you know, I'll be done by halftime with a hat on, with another Super Bowl victory and another Super Bowl ring. That was my dream, that was my vision. But every time I turn around, every play that we call, I mean, guys were right here. Now, to be honest, those of you who remember that 2001 series, season, how many times did you see defensive backs, a safety or a linebacker, on our step every single time? It didn't happen. There was no animal in 2001. That just didn't happen. But every time in this game, you know, every time I turn around, I see Ty Hall right here. Every time I turn around, I see Terrell Buckley right here. I see their safeties beating me to the spot. So something was going on. And honestly, we turned the football over, which didn't help. I think we should have ran the football more. I think that would have helped everybody. The game should have never been that close. It should have never been 17-17. And, you know, we would have never had to create this guy named Tom Brady. But I was upset when the news came out. And it's funny because TMZ, they show everything now. But we've never seen that. We've never seen the actual tape of Spygate. It's amazing how that happens. Just chalk that up for another list of conspiracies.
Okay, one more.
Yes, sir.
Who's your favorite current NFL player?
I have to get a new one. The one I have for the last couple of years, he just retired. Steve Smith. Always enjoyed watching him play. I thought he played the game the way I played the game. He was tough. He didn't take any stuff from anybody, but he dished out a lot of stuff. I think right now I'm kind of leaning towards it always been wide receiver, trust me. I'm kind of leaning towards Julio Jones. I think he has the goods. He's a good route runner, he's a big guy, he can finish plays. He plays for an organization that doesn't get a lot of limelight, and that doesn't magnify his game, but you know what he does on the field really speaks for himself. But Julio Jones, I think he has everything that you need to be a superstar as far as the wide receiver position is concerned.